We're back, folks, and this is the last session of Bunny Berrigan as a member of the Benny Goodman Band. I'm here. I'm in the Bronx, New York, and in San Francisco, we have Nick Rossi. Searcy, Arkansas brings us Hal Smith, and we're having a lot of fun listening to these recordings. This edition of the Goodman Band was very interesting, and I hope you caught our last show, which was talking about the Palomar air check. And it was as much fun talking about it as it was listening to it. And I hope it's the same for everybody. Let's go to this last studio session, Victor's session, September 27th, 1935, done in Hollywood. So it's the first Goodman big band session outside of New York City. And luckily, we have alternate takes. So we have two takes of Santa Claus Came in the Spring. Then we have Benny's longtime theme song, Goodbye, and then Madhouse. So let's go to the music, and we'll begin with Santa Claus Came in the Spring.
Skies were blue, and now it's Christmas every day, because he brought me you. Thank you. in the spring. Santa Claus came when the skies were blue. I heard his sleigh bells ting-a-ling the day that I met you. Santa Claus came in the spring, riding along through the daffodils, and I just saw him vanishing across the distant hills. I heard his reindeer on the ground. I thought I caught a glimpse of red, but suddenly I turned around, and there you were instead. What if he hurried away? Santa Claus came when the skies were blue, and now it's Christmas every day because he brought me you.
I mean, it's a masterpiece. I don't know whether it's, you know, coming off of the last show that we did was kind of like a hard to hear broadcast or something, or just the way that the band has come together. But this to me is a whole new level of anything that we've heard, I'd say. First of all, the arrangement by Spud Murphy sounds to me like he has Fletcher Henderson on his mind, or he knows that this is the way the band is going. The figures, bop, 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 there's more of the, you know, da, 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 you know, the typical Henderson syncopation that Murphy didn't usually use. The ingenuity of the section, the sectional writing. I mean, that's a, you know, anyone studying arranging for a big band, I don't care what style or what era it is, you could do a lot worse than to study that particular arrangement, the way the trombones, the saxes, and the trumpets all just go in and go out, on top of which how beautifully the band played it, which isn't even getting to the jazz content yet, or even getting to the rhythm section yet, which we'll start with Nick and without it to take us through the rhythm section. But amazing. Nice vocal by Joe Harris. And Bunny Berrigan, very interestingly, with a very tight mute that he kind of opens up a little bit. The first eight bars of his solos on both takes are almost identical. Because when I heard the take one, I started singing with it because I knew the solo by heart from the issued take. The second eight was different. So, you know, many times players would do that. They would come up with kind of a preset thing. And it's kind of like, okay, I'll do the first eight that I've kind of worked out. And the second eight will be like, you know, I Ching or something like that. And we'll see what happens. The second take that they issued was a little more brilliant. And the way that Benny reacted to Bunny on both takes was exciting. But that bridge that Benny plays on the issued take, I would put right up there with, you know, one of the all-time great eight-bar classic jazz bridge big band solos, you know, which is a certain kind of art. You know, people don't come up in that kind of idiom of when you only have eight bars to play or only have 16 bars to play. You know, the solo takes on a different meaning and you think about it in a different way. And with the great soloists and the great arrangements, you know, most notably in the Ellington band, but at cases like this, you know, with a great arrangement, a great band, the way the solo interacts with what's underneath it or behind it is like a perfect puzzle, you know, that kind of comes together. You know, the phrases land at exactly the right place where the backgrounds come in, and the harmonies, everything is just all kind of spinning, you know, in a beautiful universe. And that's, again, one of the great joys of this series. Again, whether this is the first time that you're hearing this music or this is the 1,000th time or somewhere in between, that there's always a new way into this music. And the way that we're getting into it in this series is through the prism of the rhythm section. So let's take it to the rhythm section, and we'll go to Nick Rossi out there in San Francisco and take us through what you heard.
Well, what I heard was a tremendous sense of bounce, in particularly the bass and the guitar. And, you know, we've often talked about this kind of rippling, cascading effect through the rhythm section, depending on what one person plays or what another person plays. And, you know, Harry Goodman on bass and Alan Roos on guitar really play so well together on this. And they just, they create this kind of rippling, bouncy effect that everything just sits on top of so well. And it allows those written figures to really pop. It gives Gene Krupa a lot of room to do the magic that he does. And, you know, it should be said that Jeff Stacy fits so well with this rhythm section. You know, we've now been listening to a year's worth of Benny Goodman rhythm sections. And we've heard a lot of changes over the course of a year. And it's just great to hear how quickly, you know, Jeff Stacy just fit in with the rhythm, with the rhythm group, as well as the rest of the band. I mean, we're hearing a lot of filling of the space that we talked about in the last session. You know, almost to the point where you question, is Jess playing too much? You know, and I say that from the experience of someone that plays in a lot of rhythm sections. You know, you're always sensitive about who is playing what, and who's filling the space, or who's being quiet. But everything Jess Stacy plays is wonderful, and it works so well. And you know, there's none of that kind of stepping on toes, or at least I'm not hearing it, that we've heard on some of the other sides. That for all of Frank Froba's attributes, and there were quite a few, you know, every so often he would double in the place that made it a little heavy-handed, or kind of get things crossed up. And this equation of these particular players just really makes for one of the best swing rhythm sections of this era, unquestionably.
You know, there's a element of Chicago magic working there too, because you have Jess Stacy from Chicago eventually, and Harry Goodman and Gene Krupa from Chicago, and Benny from Chicago. And I've always thought there's a certain aura around a band that's full of New Orleanians or full of Chicagoans or Kansas Cityans. And this, Benny's band, to my ears, always had that Chicago element. That's one of the things I like the best about it. These are wonderful examples also of Gene Krupa's musical mind. He found stuff to play on the first take with a little rimshot and cymbal punctuations and switching to the brushes behind the vocal. And then that wonderful open crash cymbal on the second and fourth beats behind Bunny Berrigan. And he played the same thing on both takes. It must have made an impression on him how well it worked the first time, because he just replicated it on the second take. And why improve on perfection, you know? And to address something, Nick, you said about Frank Froba doubling parts, Jess would do that behind vocal once in a while, double the melody behind the singer, but he'd get off of it quickly, maybe for two bars at the most, and then play his whatever he played after that. But I heard a little bit of it there behind Joe Harris, but not enough to detract from it. And just like he thought he could punch up the melody even more by doubling what Joe Harris was singing.
And I just want to mention also, you know, there's that lick, ba-da-ba-da, ba-da-ba-da. You know, a lot is always written about the 1 o'clock jump lick, and it goes back to what the Chocolate Dandy is, 6 and 7 times, I think it is, 1929, and they trace it here. And then the Goodman Band puts it in Fletcher Henderson's arrangement of Three Little Words, which they don't do on the Thesaurus version, but then on the Air Check they do. And you know, people notice it and say, oh, you know, maybe Count Basie was listening. Or, I mean, the Basie Band had it back in Kansas City for a chart that they called Blue Balls, you know, by Eddie Durham and Buster Smith. It was just a riff that got around. But I've never heard it used orchestrationally, like Spud Murphy uses it here in mid-1935, where not only do the trumpets play it, but it also becomes part of an interlude later. It's just kind of an interesting minor little footnote about the language that is floating around with these folks. But I'm so glad that we're all on the same page here, that, you know, it's a magical performance. And that alternate take, you know, didn't show up for years. There was a Bunny Berrigan CD on Bluebird called The Pied Piper that came out in the late 90s, I think it was. And they found this alternate take, you know, and credit should really go to Oren Keepnews, who was doing a lot of reissue producing for our BMG at that time. And, you know, he would actively hunt for alternates, which was sometimes you would ask for the Matrix number, one number ahead or one number behind, because people would just throw it in the wrong slot. And he issued it, and it came out. And that was a big boon for Bunny Berrigan fans. Well, let's go to one of the most issued Goodman sides, just by virtue of looking in Russ Conner's discography, just at 78 issues, you know, were so many. And this is the theme song, Goodbye, written by Gordon Jenkins. It's a tune that really still has jazz legs. I mean, younger players of many different styles will play Goodbye, not just Benny Goodman bands. And it's a beautiful tune. Frank Sinatra famously recorded it also. Here's the studio classic, September 27th, 1935.
Thank you.
Well, if you joined us on our last session where we heard the air check version of this particular song, you'll have the opportunity to compare how Alan Roos's guitar figure evolved, was developed, was refined, however you wanted to characterize it, over the course of roughly a month's time. He's developed this beautiful, delicate, and very kind of atypical for the era guitar figure under the main melody sections of this tune, you know, where he went from this kind of exaggerated shuffling, looping, loping sort of sound to a really kind of delicate, almost like pedal point approach. It's just, it's beautiful to hear. And it's actually something I was listening to. I want to transcribe it for myself, because I think there's a lot of really important musical information in there to be gleaned and put in my own kind of tool bag. And beyond the main figure, there was just a lot of guitar here. It played very delicately, played very thoughtfully, but all the time played very rhythmically. So he never abandons his role as a timekeeper, but he's adding a lot more musical harmonic information than we hear on a lot of these sides, which is pretty remarkable considering how much music there's going on in this arrangement. I mean, this is an absolutely beautiful arrangement. Everyone's playing so well. You know, these Jess Stacy fills kind of come and go, almost like harp runs. I mean, they're just really well executed. And beyond that, listening to Harry Goodman and his rock solid beat, you know, it allowed Harry Goodman's playing on this, I think, really allowed Roos to do what he did, which was be a little bit more free in the figures that he was playing. And it goes back to this concept we've been talking about of kind of passing the baton of carrying the responsibility of the rhythm within the rhythm section, where it shifts slightly from, you know, measure to measure, section to section. So it's a great example of the bass stepping in and maybe simplifying the bass line and really keeping down that 4-4 rhythm to allow the rhythm guitar to do some kind of more interesting diversionary type things. But that was just such a beautiful record. I could listen to that a dozen more times easily.
You know, for a pretty song, using it as a theme song, it really had a jazzy feeling, not the least of which was due to Harry Goodman playing in 4 through the whole thing. You'd think of a typical dance band theme song would have kind of a 2-beat feeling, maybe even exaggerated a little bit, but this had the same kind of intensity as like Wingy Minone playing Strange Blues or something like that from this same era. I'm really impressed by how much jazz the rhythm section put into this. And Gene Krupa being a model of restraint, just playing brushes, getting a big sweeping sound on the first and last chorus instead of that tight kind of 4-4 that he played, and leaving room for Alan Roos to play those beautiful arpeggios and for Jess to do his flourishes. And one of those actually reminded me of Duke Ellington with where it went. It wasn't hotel band piano. At least one of those was out there and in a really nice way. But I agree with Nick. I could just listen to this on a loop recording and be happy with it. What a beautiful, beautiful performance.
Yeah, it is. And it's kind of interesting as a theme closing or opening for a band with a virtuoso band leader who didn't feature himself being virtuosic at all. In fact, he doesn't play, you know, he plays the melody, but there's no moments of anything. At one point, I guess maybe it's the bridge with that flat 9 dominant chord where sometimes he would do and he doesn't do it on this record. I guess maybe it's later on he added a couple of little flourishes, but very little Benny outside of the gorgeous melody playing. A beautiful trombone solo, and I don't know who it is. I don't know whether that's Joe Harris. I would assume it's probably Red Ballard. You know, we've noted here that, you know, we found out, especially on the Thesaurus Rhythm Makers, a handful of tracks where it's Red Ballard playing. And it was the band's second trombonist. And so important, and I'll just make this element here because we're about to go to a classic among classics. Actually, every tune on this session is a classic. That The guys in the band who didn't solo, Bill Depew and George Koenig and Red Ballard and Zeke Zarchi and Chris Griffin, who didn't solo much, and everybody in the band deserves equal credit for how great the band is. Again, you know, the sports analogy is a basketball team, I guess, or some other team, you know, that's moving all the time. And there's usually a couple of people who, you know, who tend to stand out, but it's the coordination of every piece. And that, you know, with one piece of dead wood in there, as Benny used to call it, then, you know, it stops, you know what I mean? And absolutely fascinating. What an incredible recording. Well, let's go to Madhouse, and then we'll start with Hal Smith and his comments as soon as we come back. There are two takes of Madhouse. This is a piece, this is the first Jimmy Mundy arrangement that Goodman will record. Mundy was a young man who had been writing famously, playing saxophone and arranging for Earl Hines' band. And the Goodman Band will record a handful of titles and make them very famous that actually Earl Hines' band had recorded previously. And I think Jimmy Mundy would probably be the first to say, I think, that that the Goodman Band added as much new information to his charts as the way that the Earl Hines Band played them. They're really almost like two different bands playing the same music. Very interesting. Anyway, let's go to it. Thank you.
you know, Earl Hines recorded that same song a year before. And by comparison, I think his version is very stodgy. It's a much slower tempo, and he was using a brass bass, even in 1934. And I remember really looking forward to hearing what Hines did with that song, and I was very disappointed. The Goodman version is one of my very favorite records in jazz, period, and certainly one of my favorite Goodman records, if for no other reason than the rhythm section and Goodman himself. I noticed Gene Krupa played basically the same thing on both takes, hi-hat at the introduction, and didn't play it again except for the interlude. He actually kind of played an older style throughout much of that performance. He played wonderful counterpoint under Benny, a solo on top of a solo on the bridge, made things very exciting, very Chicago style, I think. To go back to
on the snare drum?
Was on the snare drum? Yes. Yeah. Okay. What we were talking about earlier, the Chicago influence in the rhythm section, that kind of thing you hear Baby Dodds or Sooty Singleton do, and Gene did it to perfection, of course. It sounded like behind Jess Stacy, he's either playing those Tim Tims, those small, thick cymbals that were mounted on the rim of the bass drum, or perhaps the stem of the hi-hat. The fidelity is not quite good enough to let me figure out which thing he was playing exactly, but he used it on both takes to very good effect, I think. Played one rim shot coming out of the first piano solo, I mean the piano solo on take one, and two coming out of the solo on take two. I remember Mr. Connor mentioned that was one way to tell the two takes apart, was one rim shot versus two rim shots. But those two guys worked so well together and seemed to feed off of each other so well, gain inspiration from playing together. Harry Goodman, of course, what a wonderful workhorse through both takes, just playing exactly what needed to be played, if that was Harry Goodman. And that brings us to another possibility. The New Orleans bassist Pops Foster claimed in his autobiography that he recorded with Benny Goodman. He said Harry Goodman was unavailable for the session and that Pops was hired to play, and then Harry showed up at the last minute, so they both played. The chronology doesn't quite work out, and neither does the location. Pops said it was in Chicago, and we've between the three of us, we've reviewed the itinerary of the Louis Armstrong band, which included Pops Foster and the Goodman band, for this time period. We're wondering if that was a possibility. I do think it is a possibility because Armstrong's band had not yet started to record as a group in that particular formation, and they were kind of scattered to the four winds at the time Madhouse was made. And particularly on the second take, the string bass playing sounds more to me like Pops Foster than Harry Goodman. And I'll throw that out there to you guys and see what you think.
I think absent Pops Foster, who a great bass player, but known to be quite inaccurate many times in terms of his claims and things that he wrote in interviews and said, that if it wasn't for that comment, I'm not sure that we'd be thinking that it wasn't Harry Goodman. Maybe not, because I think in our communications that you folks hear something different. I'll take it from the vantage point of that you maybe you have better ears for rhythm section stuff than I do. You hear something different. Okay, the way I would address something different then, because they are in Hollywood, and they're not in Chicago, they're not in New York, where there's a lot of guys floating around. But who the hell knows? Is it possible that Harry Goodman had a whole bunch of bag of tricks up his sleeve? He had heard all these people. He knew, you know, and he had a way of playing that he played. But like I would assume, like you guys, you know, I'm able to, if the situation demands it, call upon something different and try and bring something else to it that I usually don't, because I think it fits the circumstance. I don't know. So I'll just register. I assume it's Harry Goodman. But leave a question mark next to it. Where do you come out on it, Nick?
Ultimately, I leave a question mark as well, but I will say that it sounds quite different from pretty much everything we've heard from Harry Goodman at this point in time in these listening sessions. I can think of really one other side, and I can't remember the title off the top of my head, where we heard that same kind of percussive, slightly more aggressive approach to the bass. And it just, I would think that we would have heard it a bit more often if it was one of Harry's go-tos. But obviously, you know, I was not there as well. I will say, you know, just looking at the circumstances, I think Pops Foster, we can't account for his whereabouts between, I think, May of 35 and September of 35. And both of those activities are in New York. So definitely a possibility, but I also think, you know, there's a slight chance it just could be someone else that we're not, you know, aware of or privy to that could have been on the band for just the session. But the previous title sounded exactly like Harry Goodman, you know, the previous two titles for that matter. So from that perspective, why would it only be a different bass player on this last title? So again, ultimately, I have a question mark as well. I think it's a great concept that it's Pops Foster on this. I mean, that certainly makes a great record even better from a historical kind of interest standpoint. But big question mark for me.
There's one other thing we should consider on that on the piano solo on both takes. Alan Roos drops out. So there's that much more room for the other rhythm section players to do more. And did that bring something that was heretofore hidden out of Harry Goodman's bag of tricks when there's no guitar playing along?
It's possible. Plus, you know that they're recording for the first time. I mean, they've recorded Fletcher Henderson arrangements. They've recorded, you know, Benny Carter arrangements. They've recorded Spud Murphy. They've done all this. And I imagine for the band, the prospect of recording something by this new young arranger, Jimmy Munday, and it's a very, I wouldn't say far out, but it's a very adventurous piece of music. Yeah. There's some hemiolas in there. You know, there's some odd figures and challenging things. It might have been like, you know, this is something new that we're doing, and we want to approach it different because we know Earl Hines' guys are going to listen to it, and Quinn Wilson's going to be checking it out, and yeah, whomever else, and Truck Parham and these Chicago bass players will probably hear this record. And so it's possible, you know, that it brought out too. I just want to say that I would, if I had to think of one Jess Stacy solo with Goodman, I think this would be it. I mean, both takes are just nuts. And the first one, I actually like the take one solo, if I had to choose, a little bit better because he's playing along, and then when he gets to the second eight, he kind of like winds down into almost nothing. And then he pops back up at the bridge with these things, yeah, and then halfway through the bridge, he goes to these kind of like, these, you know, ding, ding, these kind of bell chords, kind of very atypical for him from what we know about him. So it's a fascinating, fascinating kind of stream of consciousness solo. And it's not long after this, right, that he'll be in Chicago recording trio tracks with Israel Crosby and Gene Krupa.
That's right.
Yeah, absolutely fascinating. Well, this has been a short version of one of our sessions. There's only three tunes, but I think we covered a lot of material. And I want to thank Hal Smith, and I want to thank Nick Rossi, Loren Schoenberg, signing out. And we will be back with the band. Our next session, two sessions, are a Goodman Big Band session and a small group session of the Goodman Small Group, which was known as the Jim Dandies, both recording in Chicago, right around Thanksgiving time, 1935. It's a very heady time for the Goodman Band because they're about to have their first national success that's going to reverberate nationally. I think what happened at the Palomar Ballroom, you know, made some noise in the press. He had a big success out there, but by the way, they stayed 2 months. This session that we just heard was done September 27th. The gig ended on October 1st. It was extended from 1 month to 2 months because the band was so hot, but still it was a local thing out in California. the gig that they're going to, which is the Congress Hotel in Chicago. They stayed there much longer than anticipated, broadcasting all the time. And I think that's the gig that really, like Ellen Kin at the Cotton Club or something like that, that really kind of broadens them out to the rest of the world. So anyway, thanks, everybody, and we'll see you next time. Thanks, Nick. Thanks, Hal. Bye-bye.